It's recording. Hello, Internet. Today I want to speak a little bit about passive intermodulation. I made it yesterday in German language and today I will try it in English. Excuse me if I'm struggling with some words, but I try it. Passive intermodulation. I will give some explanations for intermodulation. I will explain reasons and some measurement methods. It started suddenly in approximately 2010 when LTE 800 was switched on. Then the network providers saw some problems caused by passive intermodulation, but passive intermodulation, PIM, is much older. In GSM we had very narrow channels, and so intermodulation products narrow. Also, and say often they are falling between two traffic channels and doesn't cause any problems in the uplink. In UMTS we had a very wide duplex spacing between uplink and downlink, and so it was very rare but that we saw passive intermodulation in 3G in Euro bands. Why I'm discussing this topic in a video on YouTube, because it doesn't only affect the network operators who have to take care of their base stations and antennas. It also affects architects, builders, planners and installation construction companies, maintenance teams, trains, because there are repeater inside, component manufacturers, manufacturers of measurement technology, the IEC, because we are missing a standard for parts which are combined together, and the politics in Germany. We have an idea and a political idea to make one network operator serving the rural area, for example. And I will explain that is not so easy like it looks at the first look. We have, or PIM is an RF interference in the uplink, and there are several sources which can cause interference in the uplink. At first we have internal sources. This is a topic of the PIM video today, and also external sources can be causing uplink interference. We are looking in the uplink of the eNode B, and there is a receiver with a high sensitivity, and the receiver has to receive the very weak signals of the mobiles. If there is an effect in the uplink, we have a shrinking cell size of the uplink coverage. The customer sees the downlink coverage. He can look at the bars. If you have one bar, there's a very weak signal. He is at the border of the cell. But in this case, the uplink has also to work. So we have also a very weak signal at the eNode B, and if the receiver of the node B is influenced by passive intermodulation or uplink source, uplink disturbing sources, the receiver is not so sensitive as it's necessary if a customer is at the edge of the cell. If we have passive intermodulation or uplink interference, we have at first receiver problems, but the customer, sees that he can't be called, for example. Yes, an eNode B page the customer. The user equipment of the customer gives an answer and said, "Here I am." But the eNode B doesn't receive this answer, and so the customer wasn't.
This is a normal behavior in the network,
because in paging to a customer is transmitted
tracking area or routing
so
area.
So it's normal that the customer isn't in the cell. This is the worst thing which a customer can feel if he gets a call and the call doesn't reach him and this is very, very bad. The network operator sometimes doesn't see these problems because
paging
is not answered. Pagings are quite normal, and if the customer wants to make a call in the edge where, or in the cell range where the uplink doesn't cover him, the call was not successful, and the network provider doesn't see that anything happens. There's no event which can be counted. There are some other things which can caused by intermodulations, increased bit error rate, early handovers, diversity alarms of the receiver, call drops, and so on. This is the first picture where I've tried to explain passive intermodulation. There are two types of passive intermodulation. The first thing is you can see it in the vertical bars. These mixing products are well, and in the horizontal lines you can see another uplink disturbance
source, also caused by it,
and it causes a wideband noise. I call this effect a corona effect, and we will see later what perhaps happens there. At first we are looking to the receiver system of an eNode beam. Since GSM we have two receive antennas. The both antennas are necessary to receive the weak signal of the user equipment, and there are two types of post-processing of these two signals. The first possibility is to switch over to the antenna with the best bit error rate, and the second possibility is to add these both antenna systems. The decision, the disadvantage is that the receiver isn't such sensitive.
There is
an addition. The advantage of the decision method is that if there is PIM passive intermodulation on one antenna, the decision is always that the antenna with the lowest bit error rate is switched on. This is mostly the antenna with a clean signal without passive intermodulation. If you add two signals and one antenna has PIM, the whole sector is not usable. At first we are looking to external interferers. I made a talk at the 35C3 and I spoke a little about external interferers. External interferers aren't dependent on the radiated power of the eNode beam, usually. If I switch off the transmitter of the eNode beam, the sources, the external sources are transmitted. Some examples, this is a video monitor transmitting on GSM in Europe. It is made for region 2 for US. Or jammers to jammer signals in a cinema, for example, broken decked phones, which can be found in band 1 mostly, or forgotten amplifiers for terrestrial TV. They can oscillate, and they can cause carriers which are located usually in band 20, in the uplink of band 20. This was a broken headphone. The transmitter of the headphone made a strong signal also on band 20. Cameras on a filling station which made a very big noise in band 8, the GSM band, and so on. This is a repeater which is not licensed in Germany. Only network providers are allowed to build repeaters because wild repeaters can be oscillating, and these are external interferers. We have to divide if we have a uplink problem, if it is a passive intermodulation, if the source is located inside the antenna, or if I have an external source. This is the first step I have to do when I have problems in in an ENRP. So now we have the internal interference, the passive intermodulation. Our problem is that we are using a common transmit and receive antenna because we are using FDD, and there is a very big difference between the levels. The transmit power is much, much higher than the receive signals, which are received by the same antenna, and the difference is up to 166 dB, and it's approximately the transmit signal is 40 quadrillion times bigger than the receive signal. So very small new created signals on passive on sources which cause passive intermodulation can generate signals which are falling in the uplink of the affected band. Intermodulations always depending on the transmit power. If you are switching off your ENRP, the intermodulation usually is also mixtures and corona effect. Yeah, the mixture is well known. It's easy to calculate, quite easy to calculate. And the intensity, the field strength is quasi proportional to the power of the source signals. There's one difference: if I increase the power of the source signal, of the transmit power of the ENRP at 1 dB, the mixture products are increasing 2 or 3 dB. The corona effect occurs suddenly because it's another effect. It needs an initial RF power, yes, and if the initial RF power is exceeded, the corona effect, the noise is starting, and if the RF power of the ENRP shrinks under this level, the noise is going away suddenly. This I observed in frequency ranges between 300 MHz and up to 1.5 GHz. In higher bands, I don't observe this corona effect very often. As you can see here, it's a white noise. This is a corona effect. I call it corona effect, and this are mixing products. We have some other pictures where I can explain it. What's the reason for passive intermodulation? PIM sources are bad mounted connectors, shaping sharp edges, and oxide in the connectors or outside, and these are possible. Now we have to speak about a measurement value about passive intermodulation. And these measurement results, or to speak together about PIM, are given in dBc and dBm. dBc is based on the test power of a test equipment. We will see it on the next slide, how it's working. And dBm is the absolute power of the intermodulation products of third order. Yes, this is an example of PIM measurement. Two carriers which are transmitting test tones, and these test tones usually are set to 2 times 20 watts. This is 43 dBm, and if the intermodulation product is minus 107 dBm in absolute to in comparison to 43 dBm, we have a relative value of minus 150 dBc. I like dBc because it's nice numbers, and not so bad like 107 dBm. It has another advantage. If I'm speaking with dBc, it's not necessary to explain the transmit power I have done my measurement. Mixing products are caused by oxide, usually. This is a resistant which is not linear. This causes these given frequencies. For example, we have a voltage dependent resistant, like a diode, for example. You see that the sine wave
which is usually or which is normally transported to the antenna, is changed. Yeah, there are some higher frequencies on it if you calculate it by Fourier decompensation of a square wave, by a Fourier decompensation. This is an example how it works a little. If you want to make a square wave, you can use several sine waves to generate it and add them. And these several frequencies are shown here in the frequency range. And not the same, but it's equal than passive inner modulation. You get some new frequencies if you have unlinear parts in your antenna system. Oxide connectors with oxide or bad mounted connectors or something like that. And so there happens some new frequencies. Intermodulation product 3, 5, 7, and 9. And how to calculate is given here or here. Yes, you can calculate it. I made an experience in GSM. I had a broadcast channel here and a transmit channel here, and this area was blocked by the uplink downlink filter of the BTS, and this is a spectrum analysis directly connected to the old BTS. Old BTS had the possibility to connect a spectrum analyzer on it, and I can see in the uplink range the intermodulation product 9, the 11, 13, 15. And they are going wider with higher.
It's nice
orders.
To see.
And it was a broken jumper cable at the side. Yes, and now we are looking, if you have small causing signal like my broadcast channel and the traffic channel, they have a bandwidth of approximately 200 kilohertz. So IM signals are getting bigger, wider, because the outer edge of the signal are intermodulating with the outer edge of the signal, and the inner edge intermodulates with the inner. The inner is this edge, and the outer with the outer is this edge. You can imagine that is much more terrible if we use LTE, because LTE is a very wide signal, and so we have also a very wide intermodulation product. These are the mixings, and now we take a look to the corona effect. I called it corona effect. This is the noise which can occur after a given limit of the power. And in my experience, it's caused by sharp edges or tips or something else. On this sharp edges, a strong electrical field can occur. And on a strong electrical field, you have a very high electrical field. It depends on the tip. And this can cause ionization effects. Yeah, if you use a tip and are giving high voltage on it, you can see this light. This light is coming from, if an ion gets his electron back, the electron gets in a lower range of the atomic core, and this is a lower energy, and the rest of energy is transmitted as a energy, as energy quant, and it's light, and not 300 or 900 megahertz. So another effect could be happened. For example, we have a chain of ionizations or some small spark, a little thunderstorm around this small tip. I don't know it. It's an idea to explain what occurs then. And we try to calculate what's the diameter of the tip. And we calculate it from 15 micrometer to 1.2 micrometer. You have to be aware that publication and so on almost look at the mixing
it's
effect.
Good to calculate.
It's well, and all measurement and limited values are basing on mixing products and not on corona effects. Corona effect isn't, it's not possible to calculate the frequency which occurs if a corona effect happens. And but it's possible to measure it with PIM analyzers. With a two-tone PIM analyzer, you can measure this corona effect, but the result is not giving a real value where you can say this is a corona effect or not. But I can see if the antenna is broken or if it's okay. Yes. PIM sources for corona effect. I had a problem with foam for holes to make it fire protective, and someone put this connector of an in-house antenna through this hole, and so the connector was filled with this foam, and it is a very very bad intermodulation source. I think there are metallic nanoparticles in it, don't know it. And these are causing these static discharges. PIM sources also can be dust and so on in the connector itself, and or yes, such a piece of copper and so on. There are also some connectors which are good or bad for PIM. The baddest is the N-type. These connectors are loosened themselves, don't know why, and they have very bad intermodulation values. The next step is 716 connectors. They are much better, but they had to be fixed with a given torque. And the modern connectors are 4.310. And these connectors are optimized for passive intermodulation. They have a very low passive intermodulation value. There's a difference between 7.16 and 4.310. The 4.310 connector specification, if it's moved 30 times, connected and disconnected 30 times, with a 716 connector, this number is much higher. It's above 100 or 200 times you can connect such a connector. If you use 716 connectors, you have to be aware that you tied it with a fixed torque. If the torque is too low, you have the materials here doesn't break through the oxide on the other side. If it's correct, yeah, it breaks and it has a good connection. And if you tied it too tight, then the metal breaks. It makes holes and gaps and so on. Most PIM sources are loose connectors or not well connected cables in the connectors. The antenna itself. Antenna is a very complex element. Defective jumper cables, damage of cable. If someone to avoid PIM, yeah, you have to use components which are which have good quality, and you have to install antenna systems and cables and connectors very carefully. It's PIM measurement is easy, but the fault, so looking for the fault can be very difficult. So it's good to work very clean and avoid to have metal chafings or something else in a connector, in a cable. The measurement of passive intermodulation is based by a two-tone device. There are two oscillators in the device, two amplifiers, and a combiner which combines the two test tones to one line, and this is given to a duplexer, and this duplexer has a connector to outside for your test device, for your antenna system, and the intermodulation product is coming back in the same cable and has to be divided by the duplexer to the receiver part. There's a receiver which is looking what's the field strength of the chosen intermodulation product. The frequency is given by the frequencies of the two test tones, And so the receiver is looking on this frequency. This duplexer has to
it
be
needs
very
a very
high isolation, which is very high between transmit part and receive part. I think it's up to 180 dB, so the duplexer is very heavy, and the most devices for intermodulation measurements and measurement devices you can buy only for one frequency. You have to order a measurement device for 800 or for 900 and so on. Yes, these are the measurement results again, DBC and DBM. I'm speaking very often of DBC. Yes, this is the value. Here you can see some measurement devices, and you can see there are different devices for different frequency bands. This is another device. This also, and some more. Only to have a look how such a device looks like. You have to pay attention on the frequency you set on the PIM analyzer. I prefer 800 MHz for intermodulation measurements in low band, because if you have two test tones, in standard the equipment started with 971 MHz and stopped with 821 MHz, and the intermodulation product is falling in the Vodafone frequency area. In this frequency area, Vodafone user equipments are transmitting. And if you make a PIM measurement on the antenna, you can receive these user equipments transmitting, and this causes that your intermodulation result is bad, yet because the intermodulation measurement device measures power on this frequency. It's better to set the frequency so that the intermodulation product is in a gap. Gaps are very rare, but we have one between O2 and Vodafone. And if you set the frequencies to 791.6 and 816.8, the intermodulation product is exactly in the gap between O2 and Vodafone. In normal situations, no user equipment is transmitting here. In 900, it's much, it's not so easy to find a gap. There is a gap between Vodafone and O2 here again, but it's a 900 MHz band, so the channel spacing is very narrow. It can be that we have only 200 kilohertz space here in the middle, a very small
and
gap. And perhaps you can influence from user equipment's transmitting here. It's not so easy. Another possibility is to set the frequency so the guard band, so the intermodulation product is in the guard band of LTE, of Telecom, between LTE and GSM. But if Telecom increases the carrier from 5 to 10 MHz, this method doesn't work also. I prefer this measurement for all low-band antennas. It's not so important to measure with the right frequency, but you have to pay attention that the measurement equipment, the PIM measurement equipment, needs to see the antenna on this frequency range. It's not possible to measure with an 800 MHz PIM analyzer over a combiner, which is selective for 900 MHz. Practice, how to do a PIM measurement at first. It's important to install a protective adapter on the device,
7.16,
and you made a connector with this female and male to protect damage of the connector on the device itself, because if it's damaged, it's very expensive to change it. Then we make a measurement on the uplink spectrum at first. I speak about because we have to look in a gap at setting of the frequencies of the test tones, and we have to check if it's clean, and then we make a PIM measurement over time. This measurement over time, when I make a measurement over time, it's useful to tapping on the system, to look, to move the components, to move the cables, the connector and so on, to see if the measurement result is living or not. And if I have an error, I can use a PIM versus distance screen on the device. It's a fast fade transformation of swept PIM signal. It's like distance to fault, but the usable frequency ranges are very, very small, so the result is not exactly. It's you can see if it's the beginning of your jumper cable or it's or approximately at an end, but you can't locate it very good. But it's a help to see if your PIM source is outside of your antenna. This is also possible and is a very often PIM source, that you have rusty metals on the roof of a house, for example, and this rusty metal causes intermodulation. Your antenna, your cable it's all okay, but the roof is a PIM source. In in-house systems, it's the same. You have in-house antennas, and someone is building a rack, a metal rack, in near of your antenna, and this can also cause intermodulation. This you can see with distance to PIM. It's only a receiver working on the PIM analyzer. It's tapping on the devices to look if my measurement result is living or not. If it's not living, it's okay. And if I have a failure, then I can use distance to PIM measurements to locate.
Yes, there is nothing than a critical PIM value. We can't say that 150 dBc is always good or always bad. For this, I made some calculations. I will explain it in some minutes. The important thing is that your component has specifications by the manufacturer. It's given in the data sheet, and if a component doesn't fit the specification, it's broken. You have to change it or to repair it, and this is our critical PIM value. If the device doesn't fit, there's an IEC standard for components. It's called IEC standard 62037 from 1999. It's using two test tones, and these two test tones are used today. We are missing a standard for more than one component, because the standard only describes how to measure a single antenna, a single cable, a single connector, but we need a standard which describes how to measure several components in distributed antenna systems, for example, how to measure it. And perhaps we can think about to change from two tones to an OFDM similar transmit signal with not only two frequencies, or could be a lot of frequency, and the spectrum analysis beside can say this it can be passive intermodulation. It's another it's completely changed procedure, but perhaps we can think about it. Now we are speaking about passive intermodulation on different bands, and it's very easy to make such pictures. Yeah, if you see this is your downlink signal and this is your uplink frequency range, which intermodulation product is falling in your uplink range? But I tried to make it a little better. I made a calculation. I will explain how I did it. This is intermodulation product third order. This is fifth order, seventh and ninth, and I try to give an absolute value, an absolute power value of this intermodulation products. Yes. And so I try to calculate what happens if I only have an antenna with 120 dBc. Last antenna was one with 150 dBc. So our noise level, interfering level is very low. Our receiver sensitivity is approximately 100 minus 120 dBm, and the calculated signals
in the uplink are weaker than 150 dBm in this frequency range. And if the antenna is not so good, if it's bad, the inner modulation signals is getting stronger, and in my experience a value of minus 120 dBc is a critical value in LTE band 20. Then the interference starts, and the node B can see there is an uplink interferer. This is not only noise, as the noise level is it's increased.
But how to calculate it?
In GSM it was still easy. Yes, we have two carriers, one and the second carrier, and we can calculate it very easy where the inner modulation products are falling. In LTE we have a huge number of subcarriers, 610 megahertz wide signals, 1200 in 20 megahertz, and each subcarrier intermodulates with each other, and it's a lot of calculations. I made it a little bit easier. This is for example in one MIMO pass of a remote unit. It's 40 watt, 46 dBm, and if you divide this power to 600 subcarriers, you have approximately 18 plus 18 dBm for each subcarrier. This is a resource grid of the smallest LTE signal with 1.4 megahertz bandwidth, and this is the widest signal. And this one of these small boxes are containing 12 subcarriers. So these are 1,200 subcarriers in this one. And I tried to calculate it, and now I painted it in a video. I draw eight subcarriers, and now I try to check the inner modulations. What happens if subcarrier one intermodulates with subcarrier two, or subcarrier one with three, and so on and so on. And so I made it's only intermodulation product three. This is if one and two are intermodulating together, it makes a little noise here and a little noise here. And this happens if one intermodulates with three, there's a little noise here and a little other noise on the right side. And so I checked all subcarriers, what happens if the second and the third intermodulates with each other, and I noted it. And this I'm in the fifth. Now the sixth subcarrier intermodulates with 7 and 8. Here also, and the seven only with 8. And then I make a summary. These frequencies are fixed because all differences are also fixed, and so I can summarize it, and I get the possibility to calculate the RF power of these RAMs and so on. I started with a video, and I show you the video of I'm mixing two. I show you the video. If two LTE signals are mixing together, at first the blue one has its intermodulation products here. There are dots, and the green signal makes also green dots. Yes, this is intermodulation product third order, which is falling around the individual signals. And now I make the calculations, what happens if the first subcarrier intermodulates with the first blue subcarrier intermodulates with the first green subcarrier, and there's an intermodulation product falling there. And so I calculate the first red blues, the first green, the first blue, the second green, and so on. And so I made some points here, and now I can also make an addition. How often sub or mixing products are falling on a certain frequency. This is the enumeration product of the blue signal. This is the enumeration product of the green signal itself, and the red one is a mixing product of the green and the blue. And yeah, now I can add it. I needed to compare or to explain what happens with band 28 and band 20 together on one antenna. Yeah, so this is, I'm a 3 from blue, from green, and this is a mixing between blue and green. I'm going back to the slides. So I can make a picture with the accumulation of IM products. This is a causing signal, the subcarrier of the signal causing the enumeration product, and approximately 50% of all enumeration products are falling inside the downlink. Yeah, here's the edge, and the ramp falls down. On this point, you have only the interference of mixing this right left with this right with this outer right subcarrier, these both subcarriers, and the ramps increases because if I'm having more signals in the middle, the possibility is that more than one subcarrier intermodulates with another, it's much higher. And now I made it right here. I made it in a calculation, and with the calculation I made a table, and with the table I got a ramp, an absolute intermodulation value. If I have some start values, for example, I can say my antenna has intermodulation PIM value of minus 120 dBc. Am I difference between the different orders are 10 dB. My subcarriers are 18 dBm strong, and my subcarrier number is 600. Then the sheet calculates the value of the gray. The orange one is IM3. The gray one is IM5. The yellow 7. Blue is 9. And the green one is a summary of all. And now I can use this picture to overlay it on a frequency plan, and so I can see what possibly happens if I have an antenna with minus 100 dBc and this difference or this distance of frequencies. To check my calculations, I'm using a PIM standard. This is a part which is used to calibrate PIM measurement devices, and I put it on a base station. Yeah, and at first I measured this PIM standard, is that it has minus 124 dBc or minus 81 dBm by using two test tones. It's written 43 dBm, 2 × 20 W. And you know, I try to compare it with my BTS. My BTS has a possibility to make a spectrum analysis, but the spectrum analysis works well with a resolution bandwidth of 1 kHz. If I use resolution bandwidth of 1 kHz, the receiver is very narrow. Normal LTE receivers are using 30 kHz per subcarrier and uplink approximately, and so the noise values are very different. It's not usually up to minus 120, minus 121, 22 in this area. Here, for example, is an antenna with passive intermodulation is 10 dB worse than the rest. And so I have to recalculate if I'm looking to the base station, looking for the spectrum in the base station, and checking what happens with my calculation. I have it to keep in mind. At first, I have a faultless antenna. Here you can see if I use a spectrum analysis, the noise floor is at approximately 130 minus 135 dBm. I have intermodulation sources. And this intermodulation, this is the same intermodulation source with different powers. This is very low power, higher power, and this is also to explain if I increase my source power, my transmit power of the eNode B at 1 dB, the intermodulation products increase by 2 or 3 dB, in 2.5 approximately. So now I can compare this, and the first one is my PIM standard, and so I can see I have a difference between intermodulations order 5 and 7 approximately 20 dB. This is correct. This is what the theory says if I have an unlinear equipment in my a real unlinear equipment like a diode in my antenna system. It's true because my PIM standard has a small semiconductor in it, and it has this 20 dB. But in reality, we have a little other behavior. Now I checked what happens if I set here 120 dB. Okay, it's 124, but it fits in this area. Yeah, not in this area. It a little bit far away. My calculation is wrong because I'm calculating with 10 dB difference between different orders. But in reality, we have this 10 dB difference between the orders, or we have only 5 dB or 4 dB. And this side, I looked a little closer, I calculated the same. Yeah, and it's I made some noise. Hubert Epp measured the antenna, and I can say this, my calculation with absolute value is correct, but in this area my calculation is wrong, but far away it's okay again. I can say my calculation is both wrong and wrong, but also right and right, depending on the direction you have looked on it. So I try to calculate every time with a delta of the orders of 10 dB. I don't use 20 dB, and also I don't use 4 dB. For my calculations I use this 10 dB, and it's not accurate, but it's usable to have a sight on this behavior. What happens when I have a bad antenna, or where is the highest value of intermodulation, and where could it work perhaps, and so on. With single provider, it's a quite calm situation. We have a narrow signal and also my receiver.
Now I'm combining different networks providers on one antenna, and for this we need 3 dB coupling elements. This 3 dB coupling elements have attenuation. Yeah, we needed to combine the transmitters to one antenna and values for the further calculations. For example, this is an antenna with 150 dBc, and I set the transmit power to 12 dBm per subcarrier. It's 6 dB lower than the 18 dBm if I'm alone on the antenna without couplers, and my calculation results that here this area where O2 is in Germany on band 20 receiving has a high interference. In the area of telecom, the interference noise it can work. The noise is below the receiver sensitivity. The calculated noise is below the receiver sensitivity of a real eNode B. And so I made a lot of pictures. Now, this is the same with a antenna 100 dBc. It works a little with one network provider on it, but if I'm using this bad antenna, my uplink levels in O2 are going up to minus 80 dBm. It's 40 dB higher than the noise level. Yeah, it doesn't work. Now I'm looking
to repeaters. Now I'm looking to repeater and in-house systems. Repeater and in-house systems have a lower power value. I calculated with 8 dB, and in summary, for all providers, it's 41 dBm. And there I can see, yes, O2 is, with this very good antenna system, O2 can be affected by noise. Vodafone, it's better, and Telekom, it's also below the noise level. Now I looked to band 28, 700 megahertz. In band 28, we have inner modulation products of 11th order falling at the uplink. In band 20, it was in a modulation product 9th order, which was falling in the uplink. So band 28, it's a little bit easier to handle if I'm alone on the antenna. Also, if I'm combining network providers, yeah, and it's also bad because in a modulation products of 3rd order are falling in the uplink of Vodafone. Yeah. Now we take a look to band 8, 900 megahertz. For Telekom, it's filled with signal, IM7 is falling in the uplink, and the other providers have only 10 megahertz bandwidth, so the higher in the modulation products are falling in their uplink ranges. And the same is when I'm combining different providers, I'm making a very wide signal in the downlink. So IM3 interpolation products are falling in Telekom and Vodafone, and O2 has IM5. These frequencies nearby the causing downlink are very highly influenced by interpolation products. Now I'm looking to band 28 and band 20 on same antenna. It's 700 and 800 on same antenna.
And it's a very special situation because
we have two LTE signals beside, and they are causing intermodulation products. And we see if we use band 28 and band 20 on the same antenna, intermodulation products of 3rd order are falling in the uplink of Telekom if we use Telekom signals. And here in 800, yeah, we have high influence we have in the 800 uplink. And the antenna is calculated with 150 dBc. It's an antenna which is working. Yeah, power of 15 dBm, it's 3 dB lower than 18, because if one radio module makes both carriers, the power is divided to the both carriers. It doesn't work. And with change a little
other
bit,
providers
O2. Yeah, here are their downlink areas, and they have an modulation product 3rd order in their uplink in 800, and the 5th order in the 700. They will have problems also in 800. And now we are looking to Vodafone. Yeah, Vodafone, it's Luggingman. They have frequencies are very narrow together, and so they have IM5 in 800 and also IM5 in 700. Yes, and then if I'm using both all network providers on one antenna system, and this is a repeater, so a single provider, it's wrong. There's a repeater with minus 8 dBm or summary power of 28 dBm. It should work with this low power. It's a repeater with not a very, very high power, but if I change the antenna value from minus 150 dBc to minus 130 dBc, I have a big noise in all uplink areas in 700 of all providers, and also all uplink frequencies of all providers in 700, and this is 800. This is another example with combining network providers. It also should have problems. Now we are looking to band 3. Band 3 is IM3 falling in the uplink. For Telekom, the other providers are a little bit different. O2 has a narrow, it's only 20 megahertz, so they're falling IM9. in their range, Vodafone, also IM9, because they only have 25 megahertz. This is IM11 with O2. And if I change over to all providers on one antenna, I have the same problems like before. The network provider, which is nearby to the downlink area, is affected by the modulation products very, very strong. Band 1 is a very interesting band. It's a former 3G band, and it has a very wide gap between uplink and downlink. It was necessary to handle 3G phones because they have to transmit and receive at the same time, and so this gap allows the phone to divide the frequency range to transmit at the same time like it's receiving. And this is also very nice for intermodulations because we have a very big gap there. There are intermodulation products with very high order falling in the uplink. It's a little bit different if I use more than one provider, but if I'm using all providers transmitting on band 1 in the downlink area, so IM7 are falling in the uplink. It's the only band where not IM3 are falling in the uplink. This is band 7. Band 7 is 2.6. Like, as you can see, IM13 and all providers, O2 is affected. There's another problem, perhaps, if I have a combining system or antennas with all frequencies on it, very wideband antennas, so that 1800 band 3 and band 1 can affect with an IM5, 800 and 900 and much more, but you have to keep it in mind. So now you're looking to band 8 and band 20. It's quite good. IM9, the own IM9 of band 20 and the IM7 of band 8 are falling in the uplinks. It's a little bit different. Sure, if I'm using all network providers using 800 and 900, then we have, yes, IM3 in the uplink again. There's another possible problems because band 3 can interfere band 1, because I draw it a little bit so that you can see it. This is band 3. If we have all providers transmitting, IM products of third order are falling in the band 1 uplink because it's very narrow. The band 1 downlink is very far away, so band 3 can affect the uplink of band 1. They are very often outside radios serving band 1 and band 3 at the same antenna ports, at the same time, at the same antenna ports. How is the influence on the different radio bands? It depends on the radio band and why we measure IM3 and what's the PIM limit. Here are the answers. How is the influence of PIM on different mobile radio bands? It depends on a lot, from the band provider service, transmission power, the base station, and. Why we measure IM3 if it's not falling in the uplink most times? Because the components are specified on this value for IM3. Yes, this is if a component doesn't fit its specification, it's broken. You have to change it or to repair it. And so we have also an intermodulation limit, a PIM limit. If a component doesn't fit, comply the intermodulation values which is specified for, this component is broken. The IEC standard 62037 describes how to measure one component. It describes that you have to use a two-tone system, 2 times 20 watt, and you have to measure intermodulation products of third order. But there is no specification which describe how to measure several components which are connected together, like in distributed antenna systems. It is necessary because installation guys and architects and so on need a standard to measure these installations. Sure, there is increasing of the PIM value. For example, I have a lot of parts in my antenna system, cables, tappers, antennas, and so on. And every part of this antenna system has exactly its specified interpolation value of minus 150 dBZ. Then the resulting interpolation value of the system isn't minus 150 dBZ because I have several PIM sources. And we calculated as an at an example of an in-house system, and yes, there is an increasing the measurement result increases a bit, but it's approximately 3 dB. It's because if you have power dividing in an in-house system, the power it goes down because of the cables, of the tappers, and so on, and so the interpolation products are also attenuated on their way back. You can buy these standards. There are three standards at the moment. I have a wish for the practice. For this, or this wish is that the InnoDB should be possible to detect intermodulation and uplink influences as an alarm. And there's a long time which where the InnoDB is running outside, and it has to pay attention itself what happens in the uplink and generating alarms. Yeah. It is for me it's important that the uplink of the InnoDB is clean. It's not so important that my antenna system has 150 dBZ. So in InnoDB, it's important that the intermodulation or the uplink interference is not visible. Don't disturb its receiver, and so the InnoDB can have an alarm or gives an indication if the uplink is clean or not. The BTS or the InnoDB can't make a statement about the quality of the component because we can't measure in the modulation up to minus 150 dBZ because there's a power and frequency limit. It doesn't fit. But the BTS, or it's important that the base station has a clean uplink. Yes, and again, if a part in the antenna doesn't comply with a specification, this needs to be replaced or repaired. We have also passive intermodulation in repeater systems. It can be possible. Yes, this is a small house and a repeater inside. There's no coverage. And we can make an amplifier inside the house. And there's a downlink amplifier for the user equipment. And if the user equipment sends back, the signal is also amplified to the base station. And now I make the I implemented a PIM source in the service antenna, and this PIM source in my example should cause minus 90 dBZ PIM source or a level of minus 66 dBm, and this level is amplified by the repeater back to the base station. If you have uplink problems on your base station and there is a repeater connected, it can also be a problem inside the repeater, yeah, because the noise of the repeater, yeah, is given to the to the receiver of the base station. Now we are looking a little bit to distributed antenna systems, in-house systems. Yeah, how to measure it? This is a basic test method. We make a PIM measurement equipment to the systems, and we are measuring intermodulation products. This only works if this point is connected to a base station. Otherwise, with 2 times 20 watt. Other times, if it's a part of an in-house network, we have to reduce the power of the PIM tester. If we are measuring in-house systems, I recommend at first to measure on a low frequency, on a low band, in band 20, in 8800, with a given frequencies above. If I would do it very good, I can also make measurements on 8800 with 70 megahertz bandwidth. But there are no specifications depending on values, which to reach on measurement procedures and frequencies and so on. So we need an IEC standard. These are in-house systems, a lot of cables and a lot of possibilities that there can be one connector not well mounted, or a loose connector, or something else. Yeah, so this is also in our system. Here we have some PIM loads, low PIM resistors, 50 ohm resistors to make measurements. I will explain in some minutes. And this is Hubert Epp, whom made. I worked with him together and inspired me with his good ideas. He is responsible for a lot of in-house systems in Frankfurt. This is an in-house antenna. Normally it's mounted on the roof, but this is a very special antenna. It's the ground plate of the antenna is in resonance. These are antenna elements, and if you are disturbing the fields around this element, the antenna gets a very bad PIM value. You have to mount it in, for example, there's a cooling roof, for example, with a lot of metal in it. You have a PIM source near the antenna, and this antenna has very bad PIM values. You can mount it 20 centimeters below, but it doesn't look very nice. How to identify PIM problems in a distributed antenna system? For example, we have several PIM sources here, and radio terminals are caused by influence. How can I start to repair it? I recommend 800 megahertz. I have to switch off all radios from other providers, because my PIM analyzer is transmitting on a telecom frequency in Germany and on a O2 frequency, and perhaps it's listening on a Vodafone frequency. So we have to switch off all band 20 radios from other providers, but I recommend to not switch off the other radios are serving this in-house system, because every power in my distributed antenna system is adding the PIM value as a passive enumeration. So I connect only one line at first, and the other lines are connected by low PIM loads. So I disconnect them, and so I can check what happens in this floor of the building. Yeah, can I repair it or not? Yeah, and what can I do if it's too late? Oh, it's in German. At first, I can check if the loads on the 3 dB couplers are PIM free. It's very important. If you have beryllium oxide based resistors on your 3 dB couplers, it's a very big enumeration source. Then you can look for flaws where there's passive enumeration and can repair it, but mostly it's not possible because the components are not reachable, because the walls are closed afterwards. For this, I can make attenuation in the bad antenna lines, but you need to use a PIM free attenuator, and I recommend for fine leveling the spectrum analysis of an eNodeB, not a PIM measurement equipment. I have to, if it's too late, I have to keep the system back in service, and so it's important at first that this uplink spectrum is clean. It's not so important that I have 150 dBc in my system. It's not possible mostly. And if it's much too late, yeah, you can use band 1 with 4G. Band 1 has a very wide gap between uplink and downlink. And only band 1, no other bands, and perhaps band 8 with some only GSM channels, small GSM channels, and this is coverage for the floors and small rooms and kitchens and so on. And if you have an area with high traffic, you have to build a small cell or a lamp site or something else. This reduces the data rate, but you have a lot of small cells, for example, afterwards in this building. So the summary data amount you can handle is much higher than, for example, if you have carrier aggregation in a normal in-house system. Or you can separate uplink and downlink. If you have an in-house system with two antenna lines for a MIMO in every floor, you can use the first one as receive and the second one as a transmit path. You have to split it. Or I can split the providers. Which don't make influence together on the one and the other providers on the second, but it requires that you have more than one antenna line in every floor. Or if you have a lot of lines coming to the to your system room, you can build a lot of small sectors to increase the noise. If you have several PIM sources and this noise is adding, and if you have only one pass with a small PIM source, you can make an own sector, and so the noise it's low enough. Or a combination of different things for in-house systems. This is an in-house system which I can change over from MIMO to receive and transmit. This is MIMO system, and if you add uplink downlink filters on each connector of every radio unit, you can split a downlink signal to one and the uplink signal to the other line in this floor. This you can also make for different providers on these two antenna lines. Yes, conclusions. The measurement of PIM is not so difficult, but if you have a fault, it's terrible. So to avoid passive enumeration, it's better than repairing something. It's necessary that the technique itself has to alarm uplink interference or uplink interference passive enumeration. And it's necessary that the system techniques also can show spectrums on OMC or OMT to have a look from far away or local what's the behavior in my receiver, what my receiver of the InnoB sees in the moment, is there a noise or not. Not every PIM, not good PIM antenna makes influence in the uplink. Yeah, we have seen it. We have seen it in the slides. Low bands are more critical than high bands because of the smaller duplex space. If you combine different providers on the antenna, it's critical, and it's more critical if we have this on in-house. Yeah, in-house systems should be measured on band 20. It's my recommendation, and there is an ISE standard missing, a global recommendation for planning, installing, and measuring in-house systems. And not every problem in the network is a PIM problem. Now we had an end. Enjoy you, and many thanks for speakings and inspirations to some guys I written here: Tom Bell, Bill Fassenau, Peter Gray, Robert Epp, Thomas Danoch, Peter Fichtner, Ferdinand Gehardes, Eduardo Eros, Dave Bedford, Christian Enzfellner, Christian Müller, Ulrich Müller, Hans-Hubert Rührich, Stefan Wollenberger, Peter Bamberger. Allen vielen Dank. Thank you a lot, and good luck. I wish you that you have always antenna systems without PIM. Thank you and goodbye.